Hello learners, I am Dr. Manisha Vadhwa from Aditi Mahavidyalaya, University of Delhi. Welcome to this NIOS studio. Today we are discussing about teaching learning method in EVS. So today's method is field visit. As the name suggests, field visit is a visit outside the classroom. Is it picnic? No, it is not a picnic. Then what is it? So today's presentation, we will discuss what is a field visit and how field visit is used in the classroom. To begin with, objective of this session is to explain the field visit method for teaching learning of EVS and to use the field visit for teaching learning of EVS. So before going into the field visit, let's have a discussion on what are teaching learning method. When we decide that this content is to be taught in classroom, at the same time, we start thinking about how to teach that content in classroom. As a teacher, you may come up with different ideas. You may think that I can show something to students in the classroom, I can organize an activity in the classroom, or I can draw pictures and encourage children to observe that picture. So I can say that teaching learning method is a method decided by the teacher about how to present that content in classroom. If the choice of teaching learning method is appropriate, then learning becomes more meaningful for children. Every method, there are different methods, and every method has its own merits and challenges. So as a teacher, you need to weigh what are the advantages of using that method and what are the challenges. Depending upon your educational objectives, you can decide about the method. Choosing a method will have two main points. One is the content to be taught. That is very important to see that which method is to be used. For example, if I want to study plants in the school garden, then I may decide on the observation method and take children to the school garden and children will observe plants. If I want to see solubility of different things in water, then I may decide on the experimentation, bring various things in the classroom and ask children to do it themselves and experiment and see what is soluble in water and what is not soluble. In another case, if I want students to learn about horses, then I can plan a visit to a stable where children can see horses, children can talk to different people who take care of those horses, and they can actually see what do horses eat, how do horses sleep, and many other things about horses. So this kind of experience is a first-hand experience, which is a field visit to that particular place. So after content, other thing is which help us in deciding about the teaching method is the nature of learner. Different learners, they learn differently, and level of learning also dependent upon their age group. If I'm deciding about a method for class 3 students, then it may be different from class 5 children. So teaching learning method depend upon the intellectual abilities of the learner, how learner are thinking, what are their age group, it's not very easy to decide, but in a class of 50 students, all children will learn by different ways. And as a teacher, you must have observed that some are very good in handwriting, some are very good in observation, some are very good in presenting something, some are very good speakers. So there is different kinds of learner in the classroom, and we as teachers need to choose method depending upon the learners. And in EVS, we always encourage teachers to plan activities where learners are active and they learn by getting engaged in that particular activity. So field visit, as I've asked you earlier, field visit is a visit outside your classroom, but it is always planned. It is not a free period and we will say, let's go for a garden and see what are there. No, it has to be a well planned. It has to be linked to your objective. And if it is well planned and linked to the objective, then learning becomes meaningful to children and children will bring back the experiences in the classroom. So the thing which I want you to remember is that field visit is not a picnic. Field visit is generally, you know, treated as picnic, but no, number one. And the other important thing, any visit which is outside the classroom is called field visit. It can be to an open area in the school, it can be outside the school. So there is, you know, no need to think about that, you know, arranging a bus and going to a monument or going to some other places. A field visit to simple places like zoo, field visit to a simple place like Mother Dairy are the good experiences of field visit. Their field visit make learning meaningful, but it requires preparation. You should have a clarity that what is expected from field visit, what are students expected to observe, record and find out, how will they explain when they will return, what will they tell to the class. So a trip should be treated as a means of making observation and collecting data. So these are certain sites of field visit: zoo, garden, museum, post office, dispensary, Mother Dairy, monument, or any other thing which you think is a closer to your school and where taking students to that place is not a hassle. For example, I have observed that students of class 5 went to a pond which is next to the school. So the pond becomes site of field visit. There are certain steps for successful visit, for planning a successful visit. Number one, you set goals for the visit. What are the goals? The goals are determined by your educational objectives. For example, if you want students to learn about plants, then you can arrange a field visit to a nearby garden or to a school garden. Then, after deciding the site, then you have to think about what kind of activities can be arranged in that field visit site. Second step is planning for the program. So you have finalized that you will be taking children of your class to a nearby park. So planning for the program, you please go to that site and observe carefully what are different plants are there in that park. After you go and observe carefully, then after that you come back and decide how much time do you require for that field visit, what kind of activities children will do in those field visit sites. When you come back, then you explain students, you brief them, what are they expected to see, what are do's and don'ts. For example, if they are going to a monument, then they are not expected to touch artifacts in the museum. If they are going to a park, they are not expected to pluck flowers, they are not expected to pluck leaves, they are not expected to destroy or pluck plants. If they are going to a zoo, they are not expected to feed animals. So you need to explain do's and don'ts of that particular site. You also need to share safety tips with students, like safety tips like staying together, staying in a queue, not talking to strangers, be around, be in their groups. And if you are on a certain height, then don't walk on the boundaries. Then you have to also ensure how to manage that class and how children will maintain discipline. During the field visit, you need to give them time to observe, and also you need to give them opportunity to observe. You need to give them time and opportunity to observe and opportunity to speak to people, speak to organizers if that is the case. In the case of park, children need time and opportunity to observe plants. They also need opportunity to observe a gardener who is there to maintain the garden. Encourage children to ask questions, encourage children to observe carefully, and encourage children to relate it to their textbook, lesson or theme. After the visit, students are expected to consolidate the learning which has happened in the visit. You can plan different post-visit activities. You can plan discussions. You can plan question-answer sessions, quizzes, writing, or poster making, or drawing about the trip, or making a trip report. Any kind of post-visit activity is very important to make field visit a successful experience. Otherwise, a visit is done and lost. So, you have to organize a post-visit activity wherein the class can share their learning within the class and also within the school. Their experience should be linked to the particular lesson and theme so that it is a meaningful learning. So after doing this activity with children, you also need to evaluate your own field visit experience. As a teacher, whether the educational goals were achieved or not, whether you were able to relate the visit to the textbook lesson wherever intended or possible, was the situation at the facility very different than what you had seen on your pre-visit? Did the group behave as expected? So, doing all these steps, 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, you are able to evaluate the field visit. So, from planning to evaluation is the process of field visit method which is used during primary classrooms. Let's take some examples of field visit. In this example, field visit to a school garden. So, for this field visit to a school garden, pre-visit the field preparation. So, you need to see what kinds of flowers are there in your school. Children should be given instructions about observing flowers. So, what to observe in flowers? Observe their color, observe their shape, observe their size, observe their number of petals, where it grows on a plant, on a shrub, or where is it. So, they are expected to observe different aspects of a flower. They need to see some specific features of flowers. For example, some flowers grow in a cluster. So, there is a need for distribution of tasks among students. Children, for example, writing. If they are going in the field, they are expected to write, they are expected to draw, they are expected to ask questions, and they are expected to record responses. So, after all this, children come back to the class and they can have their post-field visit discussion wherein each group can discuss about their flowers. It is always a good idea that different groups can observe different flowers. So, when they come back and share their experiences, each group has different flower to share about. In another example, let's take example of a nearby park which is close to our school. And I am taking this example from a particular school wherein there was a park close to the school and there were also human encroachment in that park. So, children, they used to observe that park. So, one day they decided that we will study different aspects of that park. So, first aspect they chose was plants. They observed different kinds of plants which are there in the park, whether they are trees, shrubs, herbs, and they tried to label the plants. They also tried to classify which are flowering plants, which are non-flowering plants. They also classified them, which plants are good, which plants give us shade during summer. Another group worked on animals or living creatures. they observed different animals there in that park, different birds and insects or reptiles, they are there. They also tried to estimate number of birds, number of insects in that park. Another group worked on the habitat. They identified habitat of ants, beetles, earthworms, butterflies, pigeons, crows, chameleons and millipede. So they identified, they drew that habitat and they make note of it. The other group worked on the land. They identified different kinds of soils and rocks in that park. They observed color and shape of different rocks and different stones. Another group worked on human encroachment. They identified what different human activities are happening in that park. They observed and recorded impact of human activities on plants and insects in the park. They also recorded the impact of human encroachment on the soil itself. They also spoke to the people working in that area, living in the neighborhood, about the kind of birds, insects or plants which were there 20 years back. So you can see that different groups, five groups work on five different aspects, and each group worked in detail about those aspects. When they came back, they shared their findings to the entire class. So you can see that how, you know, one visit to a park wherein different groups worked on different aspects, and when put together, when we consolidate it, we have a complete picture of different aspects of that nearby park. Let's take another example of post office. Post office is there in our lives. Post office is always, you know, available close to school. So let's see what are the learning opportunities. Children, they have seen, must have seen letterboxes. You can take children to post office and therein they can observe that there are different kinds of stamps which are there. There are different kinds of envelopes, inland letter, postcard. They can observe that how postmen sort the letter. What is this pin code? How they sort the letter, which they sort the letter according to the, whether it is a speed post or registered post or something, you know, registered post with acknowledgement. So they sort the letters according to this different types, and then they sort the letter according to the places. So probably they sort it, they observe that the postmen, they sort the letters through that, which letter goes to metro cities, which letter goes to small towns according to the pin codes. And they also observe that post office is beyond letters, that post office have also services like money transfer and saving schemes. So any visit to any place make it a meaningful only when, as a teacher, you are able to see what are the learning opportunities in that place. And this visit will become meaningful when you link it to the chapter in the textbook. So let's see that field visit has different advantages. One, yes, you are right, it is a first-hand experience. When I'm going to a post office, I can observe, you know, how that postman is sorting those letter, putting those letter in different cubicles. So if I have seen it, I will remember it. I can also see that it is done in front of my eyes, so I am able to make sense. It becomes a part of my experience. And going to a field visit site make it a joyful and memorable experience. Let's take another example of a paddy field. Students of a school, they observed that how paddy is grown. So for that, students were divided in the groups. They were expected to ask questions from the farmers. And when they went to the field, they actually saw farmers sowing rice. And they observed that rice is first sown in small nurseries, and from there, saplings are sown in the fields. Children observed that when saplings were sown in the field, how farmers stand in water and they sow. Some of the children even participated in that sowing. So imagine a 8-year-old child in a paddy field and observing how paddy is sown. So do you think that child will ever forget it? No, child will not. And especially when child is part of that activity, when child is sowing that paddy in the field. So they saw that how the paddy is sown. They spoke to the farmers. They came back to the school. After few months, they went again. And then they saw that how it is harvested. Farmers explained to them that how paddy is harvested, how they take out, and then they take it to the mandi. So field visit is one, I will say that one consolidated learning wherein they see it from beginning to the end. So field visit can be one session, it can be more than one session wherein children observe it very carefully. It is always good idea to link field visit with other methods of teaching. For one, you can always see that field visit with link with observation. You can link field visit with experimentation. You can link field visit with creative expression, wherein children are expected to write about their experience, their first-hand experience. They can be as creative, as informative as they can. So this kind of expression they've used. So field visit, we have seen that they have linked field visit with observation, field visit with creative expression. You can link field visit with experimentation, wherein children can come back and do experiments and see what happens. In this particular case also, they can, this visit to a paddy field, they can come back and sow their own seeds and see that how it germinates, what are the good, you know, what are important factors for germination. So by this, field visit is linked with experimentation. So they take different seeds, they take different pots, they will place it, they will identify which are the factors which are important for germination, and we'll try to eliminate one by one factors, and we'll see what is important for germination. So I will say that when I am clubbing field visits with some other method, it will become more meaningful. We have seen that we have observed field visit with observation. We have linked field visit with creative expression. We have linked field visit with experimentation. And in last, we can also relate or link field visit with discussion when we come back and discuss. For example, in this visit to paddy field, we can discuss how, you know, how the tools have changed over the years. Children can speak to different people in the field, different farmers, and they can ask them ki how the tools have changed, how these tools have make sowing more easy for them. So these are certain kinds of activities you can always link with field visit, but you can always make field visit more meaningful. There are different advantages of field visit which we have discussed, and I will like to summarize now that it permits first-hand study of many things, both natural things like forest, biodiversity park, and man-made things like dams, factory or locality that cannot be brought into the classroom. One has to go out and see what is, go out, see and experience and bring that experience in the classroom. Secondly, field trip offers learning experiences for students, giving them greater understanding of natural and technological world in which they live. So, I will summarize that you need to make a distinction that field visit is not a picnic. Number one, field visit is a visit to a meaningful site. Number three, field visit has to have some linkage with textbook content or textbook concept. It is not out of the blue that we decide that we will go somewhere. No. Number four, field visit is not, you know, going to a place of convenience. It is going to a place of learning. Next, you as teacher should know what are the learning opportunities of a particular field visit, and then only you can plan for a field visit. When you are planning for a field visit, you need to have some activities. You need to have some activities which children will do. You need to plan it well in advance. You should make groups of students, how different groups will work differently, what is the role of each group member in the field visit site. For example, if I made a group of 4 students, then all 4 students should have a clarity what is their role, what are they expected to do at that field visit site. For example, in the coming back to that paddy field example, if I made a group of 4, then what will they observe, what questions will they ask, who will ask question, who will record answers, and how will they record their observations. So all these aspects, they need clarity before going to the field, so that students are not confused, you as teacher are also not confused, you have clarity what are you expected to do. Thank you very much for this session, and we will meet you again in the next session. Thank you.